Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Madam Secretary, for being here. I promise to apply a combination of Midwest nice and a little bit of my former investigative journalism background. But anyway, so interesting conversation. Thank you again for being here. So we are in the middle of a public health crisis, not just the coronavirus, but youth vaping. And my folks in education back home asked that I call it e-cigarettes, because they think vaping makes it sound nicer than it is, so I will say e-cigarettes. But the numbers that we have from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention show that back in 2011, we had 1.5% of our high schoolers were doing e-cigarettes. Now, just last year, 2019, we're at 27.5%. So about a third of our high school students are now doing this. I mean, just alarming. That's why I call it an epidemic. At junior high and middle school, we are now at about 10.5% of our middle schoolers. So I just couldn't believe these numbers when I learned these. We did a series of roundtable discussions in my congressional district in downstate Illinois. And the one that really just alarmed me was that we had a school resource officer said that there was third graders that were doing this. Third graders. And you know, this is easy to hide. They can put it in watches, they can put it in clothing, they can do it on these fake jump drives. So they're doing this. And that's why we wrote a piece of legislation out of my office called the Resources to Prevent Youth Vaping. It is part of a bill that we, a package of bills that we'll be voting on the floor tomorrow. And so what I wanted to ask you, I promise I'm bringing this totally into your department. I'm wondering if the Department of Education is coordinating with the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention to make sure that we have information that we can get out to our parents, make sure that we have resources that the teachers know about, that the school nurses know about, and just wondering if there's any kind of coordination going on with your department and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
Thanks, Congresswoman, for that question. I know that there have been participations in task forces. I'd be happy to check on the extent to which those are happening and get back with you on that.
Okay. Yeah, if you could work with our office and make sure mm-hmm. that we are aware of this. I think it's really just a commitment on your part. We were just with Secretary Azar yesterday. But I think working together will just be absolutely critical to help address this. Again, this is a public health epidemic that is impacting our students, our children. So I think that would be great. Switching gears, the other issue, I liked it. Lois Frankel was saying, I'm guessing you're going to ask something about Illinois, because I stay pretty focused on my own congressional district. Really, really severe teacher shortage that's happening all over the country. In the congressional district that I represent, we're 14 counties, and we have seen the teacher shortage problem actually increase over the last year, actually increase by about 20% that we're seeing now. So in 2019, there were 195 teacher vacancies in these 14 counties that I represent. Now there are 235. That's just over the last year. So this problem is getting worse, not better. So I know in the president's budget, just a few things I want to point out for the record that are concerning to me. The Public Service Loan Forgiveness Fund has a proposed cut of $50 million. Teacher Quality Partnership Grant Program has a proposed cut of $50 million. The funding of the Supporting Effective Educator Development Grants, proposed cut of $80 million. Supporting Effective Instruction State grants cut of $2.1 billion.
Can I just Please. Interject? Because a number of the programs that you've cited are actually the ones that we have proposed to include in the block grant and would actually be very appropriate in your case and in your district. If there's a drastic shortage, the districts could target more of those resources and have the flexibility to use more of them for programs that would address the teacher shortage issue, teacher retention, teacher development, and in fact give them a lot more flexibility than the current scenario.
So talk me through then, if you could, in the 17 seconds we have left, talk me through about how specifically, so you've got the block grant proposal. This is a mostly rural district I represent. 7,000 square miles, again, a lot of smaller schools. How will these block grants help specifically recruit, retain, and fill all of these vacancies in a very, very rural congressional district?
Well, what it would do is allow for the districts to prioritize what portions of these 29 different programs would be most effective and most important for the needs in their district to meet the needs of the most disadvantaged students. And it would allow them, again, to personalize and prioritize where those needs lie more specifically than the approach of having 29 different programs, all with their own rules, all with their own regulations. These would be block granted to the state, and then 90% of them would go out directly to the districts under the Title I accountability and formulation. So all of the accountability provisions there, but much more flexibility for every district to be able to target the resources where they need the most.
I'll yield back the time that I don't have left. Thank you.